You've got peace like a river.
I absolutely do.
Absolutely do. That's good to hear. Joy like, what was it?
Fountain,
right? Do you have joy like a fountain? And the ocean was
love,
right? Love like an ocean? Yeah, those are bold statements, aren't they? Especially because we live in the world that we live in. And it doesn't seem like we're having love as an ocean as a society. Maybe little drops here and there. The peace of the rivers, a lot of that has dried up, like dry riverbeds. Although we came over the Susquehanna River this morning and it was full. So hopefully you and I will both learn how to have more peace like a river and be able to sing. There's a great song we're going to do a little bit later, "It Is Well." We're actually going to focus on that idea and that song this morning. And we'll have plenty of scripture as we go through here, but we're mainly going to look at each of three verses of this song, and then look and see what they say, and hopefully internalize that, so that our peace can rule, God's peace can rule in your heart and all of our hearts today. And I'm hearing some popping, and is that normal? I did this differently than last week, but I've got the thing hanging out of my pocket. I don't know. We'll see. Okay. Well, this morning, as we go on, I want you to hear the message of this song, and I want you to connect them with difficult things in your life. Because every one of us has come in here this morning with things that trouble us. And I think if we went around the room, and we're not going to do that this morning, but if we went around that room, we would find that there are places of physical pain or emotional pain. There are all kinds of pain that we brought in here today. And I really appreciate, Doug, part of your prayer early on was, Lord, let us give you all the things that are worried, that we've carried in here. Can we go to the next slide? I'm really not reading this manuscript this morning. But here are the words. Can you read that? Is that big enough? Okay. Let's read this together this morning, then I'll pray. When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever morning comes, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Let's pray. Lord, we say those words, and we live in a world where our experience is that the sea billows are rolling, and we're being tossed from here and there in the hole. We hear the news, and it's just one group fighting against another, and whether in actual war or politics or there's just so much conflict, and even in our lives, we have problems at work, or financial issues, or relationship issues, just everywhere around us, Lord. Help us to have your peace and to be people of your peace. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. As we go through this song, and the message that it has for us, this is going to be our outline today. The trials are going to come, that you remain in Christ, and that you, hopefully, can say, it is well with my soul. The first two of these are facts. They are absolute truth. They're experience. That's what we know. But they're also theological truths. The trials are a part of this world. And you remain in Christ. If you are in Christ, you will remain in Christ. And so, therefore, you can say, it is well with my soul. Trials are going to come. Satan is going to buffet you, as it says in the song, trials are going to come. You might be tempted to wonder when it's all going to stop, because if it's not one thing, it's another, or three or four other things at the same time. And we've all had a rough couple of years. I mean, we're still dealing with COVID and everything that that has brought into our society, some divisions and some, even in families, there's still divisions over this. But we've all had a couple, rough couple years, and we've all had to deal with this. Well, there's a big difference in how people live with what upsets them. Next. Unbelievers do not have the same peace that believers have. Unbelievers do not have the peace that comes from knowing God. In Isaiah 57:21, God says, "There is no peace for the wicked." And this is not just about what God is technically, theologically, those who do not believe in Jesus Christ, who have not received the redeeming blood of Him, are outside of the body of Christ. And wicked is a difficult word in our society today. We don't want to say that people are evil or whatnot. But what is really being said here is that those who don't follow Christ, who do not have Christ, there is no peace in them. I've heard so many people say throughout the years that it was their faith in God, that it was God's presence with them that helped them through one trial or another. Whether it was the loss of a spouse, loss of a job, some issue with a relationship, that it was really God who made the difference in their life, and that's what they held on to God through that. And they look at their neighbors who are going through things and wonder, how do those people find peace without God? They know that God has helped them through so many things. Well, God's peace is there for believers and not there for those who are in Christ. I know, and this is not, I cannot give you any kind of proof that there is some sort of scientific study. Do we need this? I don't. Further away, it just seems to be, maybe it's just me, right? I don't know. But in my experience, people who are dying or at the moment of death, if that person is a believer, if they have publicly stated and they've tried to live as a believer in Jesus Christ, those people die more easily and more at peace than people who've not claimed Christ as Savior. That there is a lot more anxiety, even at the moment of death, even on the person's faith, on their face, it just looks different for the people who die in Christ or not in Christ. And I have seen that before I was a hospice chaplain, now as a hospice chaplain, the folks who say, well, I'm a Brethren or Mennonite or some really faithful Lutherans and Catholics even. Well, Catholics even. They have the same Lord. Yeah, sorry. But it's, does a person believe in Christ as their Savior? That's the difference. That's where peace comes from. Well, Jesus' followers have the advantage of Jesus being with them. In John 16, it says that I've told you all this, and Jesus has been talking to them about some difficult things that are going to be happening. I've told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. And do you know what he says to his disciples now? I have told you this, so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows. God does this for you, that you remain in Christ always. You are there in Christ, no matter what your trial. And here's the second verse of the psalm. That though Satan should buffet, actually, let's read this if we can. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance be told, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. The God of peace has made peace with you through Jesus, and you remain in Christ. In the book of Acts, chapter 10, next, please, thank you. Chapter 10, verse 36. Peter is preaching to a group of people, and he says, you know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. Peter says that when Jesus came, when he was preaching, and when he was teaching, he was announcing the good news of peace. Not the good news of God is going to get revenge, or there will finally be justice in this world, and all the, that God's going to crush all the evil people under his thumb, and we would all be in trouble if that were the case. But the good news is peace through Jesus. Jesus saw you as helpless and shed his own blood for your soul. All your sin was nailed to the cross, and you bear it no more. It was God's perfect work that did it, God's perfect love. If you had done it, then your salvation would only be as strong as you are. It would only be as good as you are. And so you and I needed someone stronger than us to be our Savior. And I know there's some really nice people in this room. Every one of you, I'll just say every one of you. Really nice people, good people in this room, but not good enough. Not nice enough. No one is perfect. Only the perfect God can bring perfect peace. Only God can make you, put you, keep you in Christ. And when you are in Christ, you are theologically, positionally at peace with God. Now, we have to live that way. We have to get there in our hearts and minds. But you are at peace with God. And the God of peace is with you. In Philippians 4:9, Paul says, whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. And the God of peace will be with you. The God of peace. Don't be afraid. God is with you. Don't doubt. God is with you. Don't be anxious. God is with you. Do not turn back from what God has for you. God is with you. Do not ever put yourself first. God is with you. And if God the Father was willing to give up his Son for you, what is he going to hold back from you? What would God keep away from you? What good thing would God withhold from you if he's already given his Son to you and for you? God's peace will be with you. And you will be able to say, it is well with my soul. Can you read that line? I wasn't sure about this slide. Can you read it? Can you see it? Okay. Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be silent. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trumpet shall resound, and the Lord shall ascend. Even so, it is well with my soul. The even so, it is well with my soul is kind of like saying, in the meantime, Jesus is coming. There will be an ending. In the meantime, it is well with my soul. And you will be able to say now, hopefully you can say, it is well with my soul. Because someday all the problems of the world will be done with. And let me explain it to you like this. In the Bible, chapters are there where everything is good and perfect and just exactly the way God wants it to be?
Zero.
Not zero. I'll show you. Genesis 1 and 2. There are two different, they're complementary creation stories. Where everything, God makes everything, and God says it's good, it's very good. Well, okay, then we skip a little bit, and we go to Revelation 21 and 22. The very last two chapters, where everything is good, and God is not created, God has recreated everything, and everything is good and very good. So, what part of the Bible do we live in? We live in this part of the Bible. Ever since Genesis 3, humanity has been living in this part of the Bible. And that's a lot of the Bible. Now, we could say the first two chapters, God creates. The last two chapters, God wins. In the middle, in the mess, in the middle, God saves. In fact, that's the whole Bible in six words. God creates, God saves, God wins. That's it right there. Creates, saves, wins, and it's all God's working. That God is going to deal with sin and Satan and everything we see, death and disease, rebellion, lack of faith, there will be an ending. It will end one day when God will remake the world. And God's peace is going to happen then. It is available today. But God's peace is available now. And this is Philippians 4, 16 to 20. The God of peace is going to take care of the future. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus be with you, it says at the end of the book of Romans. Notice how the God of peace is going to crush Satan. That doesn't sound very peaceful, but that is how God is going to bring peace into the world. But Satan has already been defeated. Death has been defeated in Scripture and in God's mind and in reality. Those things have been defeated. We still live with those things. They still rule over us in a way, even though God is higher than those things. We're still subject to Satan and death. But the God of peace will soon crush Satan. Now, I know a lot of people have been saying, oh, it really feels like this is the end. And maybe it is. We're definitely getting closer every day. We're getting closer to every prophecy, everything being fulfilled in Revelation and places in the Old Testament where God's going to put things, he's going to take things apart first and then he's going to put them back together. But this will happen soon. So don't be anxious. God's peace is available now. Next slide, please. God's peace is available now. I keep saying this over and over. This is the last scripture we're going to read. It's actually verses 5 through 7. But can we read this together? The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I have a confession to make. Speaking of confessions, which we did at the beginning, some background. I grew up in an American Baptist church, and my parents say I was born on a Tuesday and I was in the nursery on Sunday. So my whole life, I've been going to church and been taught the Bible, been taught what is right and good in terms of behavior. When I was 11 years old, some different ideas came to me, and I knew that I had received Christ. It wasn't just Jesus died for all the sins of all the people in the world, but that's what I point to as the day, the time that I accepted Christ. But it was more like a journey along the way, and then this important thing happened, but it wasn't like at 11 years old I was out sinning and doing all these bad things. But anyway, I lived probably for the next 40 years with the idea that faith and living for God was finding out, okay, here's a passage, and here are the three most important things that I need to do today. For a long, long, long time, that was faith, living my faith. When I turned 50, and so when I was here, you all were under the, the not as informed Tim. I apologize, I'm sorry. But when I was 50, 51, some things happened to me, and I realized that my faith was a mile wide and an inch deep. And I really had to think about my whole life and how I did my job as a pastor, and it was kind of an unsettling time, really unsettling time. But I had some help from some good friends, really have come to understand that faith is not knowing the three or the five or the 12 things that I have to do every day to be a good Christian. Faith is knowing that God is near. Faith is seeing God in life. And that's what Paul says here. You know, it's pretty obvious in Scripture. The Lord is near, so don't be anxious. It doesn't start with don't be anxious. It starts with the Lord is near. Look for the Lord. Where is God in your life? What is God teaching you? How is God holding you in this moment? How is God lifting you up in this time? But faith is knowing that God is near. And that's Horatio's story. That's the guy who, you saw his picture early on. Horatio Spafford is the guy who wrote this song. And I know he was a Christian. And being Christians, we know that God controls everything intellectually. We know all these things. But do we really feel it? Do we know it? I mean, we know it up here. How long does it take for it to get here? A long time, sometimes. Well, the guy that we're looking at now, we could just go to the next slide. This is Horatio Spafford, the man whose trials gave us the song, It Is Well. Horatio Spafford was from Chicago, Illinois. He was a very wealthy man, very wealthy businessman, in terms of how the world measures wealth. Lots of businesses, lots of money, possessions, big house, until the Great Chicago Fire of the mid-1800s. Well, after the fire, during the fire, his businesses were completely destroyed. And he and his wife had five children at the time. His oldest, who was a boy, died of scarlet fever. And so that would have been a very difficult thing. But he was a Christian, and he was a good friend and supporter of the evangelist D.L. Moody. Have you heard of D.L. Moody? Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's still a Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. Fine school, good people. preaching in London, and Spafford, things were not going well at home, so he and his family were going to go to London, England, to attend the revival meetings. Well, Spafford had some business things he had to deal with before he could leave, so he sent his wife and the four daughters ahead while he took care of some things. Well, on that voyage, their ship collided with another ship and sank in 12 minutes. All four of the daughters were lost. His wife sent him a telegram from England saying, "Saved alone." So all five of their children gone. Horatio got on the next ship to England to be with his wife. On that voyage, where they passed over the spot where the daughters had died, where the accident happened, the captain pointed this out to Horatio's family. Immediately, Horatio left the side of the ship and went into his cabin and wrote these words: "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." Even in the loss of practically his whole life, sounds very much like the book of Job, actually. He could say, "It is well with my soul." Now, did he have a perfect faith from then on? No, he did not. But he was wise enough to say, "God, you have taught me that you're still teaching me to say, it is well in all the troubles." And I don't know all of your troubles, hardly any of your troubles, but God knows them. And God is going to keep you with him and keep you trusting him. In Philippians, where it says that God will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, the King James Version has a little bit different translation. Do you know the King James Version of that? God will keep you in Christ Jesus. Now, in 1611, or the early 1600s, when that King James Version was being put together, there were still a lot of other castles in England now. But building castles was still a thing because of, wanting to protect yourself. And the way a castle is built is there's an outer perimeter, right? The outer walls. And then inside there are buildings. Has anyone been to England? Been in a real castle? Okay. You know, they're different designs, but there's an outer wall and some buildings, and somewhere in the middle, there might even be another fortress inside the castle. And right in the center, the most secure place in the castle was called the keep. Keep is a verb and a noun. In 1611, keep was a verb and a noun. And the writers of the King James said, when you give your heart to Christ, when you acknowledge him, God puts you in the keep, in the safest, strongest place in all of his castle. And he will do whatever he can do to defend you and keep you in Christ Jesus. So it doesn't matter what it is you're going through. You can say, "It is well. It is well with my soul." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the promises of Scripture that say that you will keep us, you will guard us, you will be with us. Help us to see you, Lord, and to live as people of your peace. Receiving your peace, having your peace, and holding it in our hearts. And then, Lord, also giving your peace away to others. That there would be people around us who see you working in us and who desire, that awakens a desire in them to know you. Lord, may this church be a place of peace. May this church be known as peaceful people and folks who get along and like each other and have a good time together and support one another.